their own ideas of what is powerful, but it seems like the laning dominant C9T might be looking to those champions.
Yeah, and you can see a Gangplank actually banned against solo. It seems like he's been practicing that in solo queue. That leaves Olaf up. That leaves another carry top laner. I like the Azir ban and the Sivir ban against Steelback and Mancloud. They're definitely a tier above the rest in those guys' champion pools.
Yeah, yeah, those are easily those guys' best champions. So far, very smart bans by C9T. Even though Lod, of course, is a good Sivir player, I can respect sort of dropping off the S tier of another player. Final ban comes through as Elise for Team Imagine. Now, Moon's Nidalee, of course, is still up. He was carrying on Nidalee and Evelynn specifically really hard in the prior series. And it seems like carry junglers are the big thing to play on really both sides.
Yeah, I think that's definitely the way to go. You know, hard, he can fall back on the Gragas and the Rek'Sai. He's played them a lot, but Moon's success has been Nidalee, Evelynn. Elise banned away as well, but he's going to be able to lock in an Evelynn first pick if that's what they want to go with here on Team Imagine side. But they already pinched top laners Gnar and Gangplank off, so
that's
I'm assuming
true.
They're going to take something up here for solo in the first round. They will get a counter pick on Imagine side if that's what happens, but I feel like you have to just grab the priority pick while it's still up.
Yeah, and we were talking about Olaf and Gnar being really big, and the fact that actually C9T was picking Olaf first round red side, even in their coast matchup as well. So, I think that's actually pretty likely here. So depending on what they get for the rest of this pinch, though, I think, yeah, Olaf's definitely smart, but seeing what they get secondarily here, every single support is up. I don't think you'd really see a Braum. I don't think it's a big enough deal when Alistar or Janna are both still up that it feels like it's not required.
I have this kind of, like, Kobe and Jat and I were going back and forth on what, like, the S tier is right now, and
yeah.
I feel like Olaf has cracked into the S tier of top laners, and I feel like Braum is actually cracked into the S tier of supports.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like if you let Braum go away when you have a team composition that doesn't exactly just want to do one thing, and that's go in, because he's very defensive. He also has offensive capabilities, so he's kind of like an Alistar, but with more defense.
Okay.
Because Alistar's very offensive support.
Yeah.
He can peel in team fights, that's fine. And then Janna's just the polar opposite of just a ton of disengage.
Yeah, I mean, Braum basically essentially blinds your mid laner and enemy AD carry by just saying it has to hit me instead. You can't hit our squishies. So, yeah, it's interesting here. Either way, the pickup ends up being Kalista there, so they go for the top tier of the AD carry pool. We'd actually seen her banned away a lot in playoffs. Still, of course, a high-prized ADC. Sivir gone away. And instead of letting Sivir get picked and playing the counter matchup, they just don't want Sivir in at all.
Yeah, so I assume that Steelback's going to fall back on Corki or Tristana. Those are both up. We do see a Braum get locked in here,
okay,
though. And then Mancloud actually just goes one champion down on pretty much the tier list from Azir to Viktor, which everybody's just all about right now. There has been the mid Lulu that we saw actually rise up in the TSM set. We saw it in the TIP set in playoffs.
Yeah,
so Lulu's actually jumping up the tier list as well.
It's interesting to see how players perceive the power level of different champions, even though they don't even change. The champions don't go anywhere, but everyone's like, you know what, this one's actually more valuable than we actually realized. So, interesting to see those trends develop over time. Team Imagine, so far, I actually like this lineup. Pretty high damage. I do like that Moon is on a strong Runeglaive jungler. This is his style. He's one of the probably best players on this team overall. He has the ability to impact that. I also, by the way, like the fact that because Solo is going to be playing pretty aggressively, they have a strong ganking jungler, something that can actually affect the split push, and Moon can make the top lane matchup work well. Meanwhile, C9T go for their side of things, actually go for a tank jungler for hard. He gets back on that Gragas that he played in the last set, and there's just a safe Janna for Sheep.
Yeah, I was assuming Gragas or Rek'Sai for hard. Sheep, though, you know, Thresh is up. Thresh into Braum, it's an okay matchup. He'd still Alistar, which is something that he's fallen to, but going with the Janna usually means that he's going to try to really empower this team, and there's some disengage here. There's a lot of peel back.
Yeah.
But Olaf wants to run forward, so there's a little bit of a dis-synergy there, but if they can actually just have the right team fight, push people back, get Olaf into their backline if they're charging into you at the same time. It's this weird dynamic where a team fight has to go a certain way for you in order to come out with a perfect victory, because there's always
right.
a way to play out a team fight, even
sure.
if it's not the ideal strategy.
Yeah, it's weird. There really is no like extra dive buddy with Olaf, and without giving him dedicated tankiness with like a, I'm going to say a Galio for some reason, but like even a Lulu mid you mentioned before, like something like that then makes his work a whole lot better. So.
We saw a lot of Lulu with the Olaf. It
right.
just enabled him to go even faster. They added the movement speed to his Ragnarok for 1 second when you pop it, but Lulu giving him this constant movement speed burst is incredibly scary. You're an AD carry player.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've been able to run into
so
any Olaf Lulus
I,
yet.
When we first tested the big set of Olaf changes, like 2 years ago, whatever, I had to play against Olaf a few times, and I was like, if he's ever ahead, I don't have anything I can do. Like, it perma-slowed and can't kite him away. Like, I hope I'm playing Caitlyn, and even then I hope I'm 1,000 range away when the fight starts.
And you have Flash, you just...
Yeah, like, I have to Flash over a wall, and then maybe I'm safe, and it was really, really difficult. So, yeah, life's gonna be hard, and we'll see the Lulu is getting hovered right now. Meanwhile, the Imagine comp comes through. Just a very solid, aggressive team fight composition overall. A lot of burst here. Viktor, Plus Corki, plus the Hecarim is really solid
good
at going
in. Damage.
Yeah. And C9T, it's really Olaf-centric, honestly.
Very Olaf-centric. Yasui, most likely. I've been seeing with the change to AP items, Lulu's going a little more damage impactful, going for the Luden's Echo, going for those types of things, so they actually have a damage threat in the late game to be an AP threat.
Well, because they have to buy 80 AP or 100 AP regardless. Like, yeah. Not even like there's really options. Everything has high AP, so it works out.
But the Luden's Echo was one that people weren't really getting at first when it came out on Lulu, and then they started getting it. The movement speed increase is really good. Mm-hmm. I mean, even better so for Lulu now.
Sure,
but,
yeah.
Looking at the composition from Imagine, though, it's very good mixed damage. I like this. They have some poke there. They have the Braum to stop any sieges against them. And then they have Chunky Fresh. He likes the Scion. He likes the Hecarim. Getting the engages is important for Chunky Fresh, because if he starts his team off on the right foot, that's how they win those fights.
All right, well, he's got 4 feet to use on that Hecarim. We'll see if they're going to get the right one here. As you load onto the game, we're going to know who's going to win this one. So tweet to us, let us know who's going to take it, who's going to get into the promo tournament at LOL Esports, hashtag IMGWin, hashtag C9TWin. We're going to share those votes in a few minutes into the game, but let us know, best of three, winner gets to face enemy Esports or teammate in a best of five for a spot in the LCS.
So, starting off on the right foot, if you have 4 feet, does that actually
make
you have
two right feet.
But I'm just saying, if it's the right foot, not just right foot, because that's singular.
A right
which
foot.
Which one is
the right foot?
The right.
Oh, it's actually harder on him.
It's harder, right?
25% chance to choose correctly.
50%.
It's going to be difficult then, Chunky Fresh. Can you pick the right foot? I can't believe you went for that one, Zyrene. We are into the game. Team Imagine versus Cloud9 Tempest. Yes, guys, this Challenger Series, we say things like this.
I had to kind of deconstruct your whole thing and be like, you know
it.
What? Hecarim might be a detriment. But it's not. It's one of Chunky Fresh's better champions. We'll see what they're able to do on it. But I'm very curious as to what comes out here from C9T. Solo, we talked about him being very pivotal in their success. High kill participation, likes to get a part of the action from the top lane and see what he can do with that TP. And if he can get priority on this lane, because it is a Hecarim. Hecarim doesn't have escapes. When Olaf gets ahead, you're going to be blowing his ultimate. You're going to be getting Hecarim out of these fights and chasing him down the lane with constant slows. Mm-hmm. And I remember when Olaf top was becoming a thing for a bit, it was back when Jarvan was extremely popular. You wouldn't be able to take Ghost, and it kind of dissuaded people from going from the really just run you down Olaf, because you had to be able to flash out a Cataclysm at some point.
Yeah, Jarvan would just like wreck Olaf, and it made it really difficult.
But now with Jarvan out of the picture, it's been a long time, buffs to Olaf, Olaf is no longer Olaft, and he's better.
Yeah, Black Cleaver definitely helped him a whole lot, and also people just realized his actual... That's always the weird thing with reworks, actually, when because you brought up the term Olaft. Again, I will admit that Black Cleaver made the champion better, so we got stronger after a certain point. But one of the difficult things always with new champions or rework champions is part of the power of a champion is building them correctly, right? Imagine you like didn't realize to build Trinity Force and Hecarim. Hecarim would be weaker. And it's funny, like if you look at all the common builds on Olaf up until Zion Spartan played a bunch in LCS, it was like Righteous Glory first item, no offensive, full tank. And then people realized if you go Cleaver, Hexdrinker, you kill things really fast, this is the build, and suddenly Olaf is stronger because of playing him properly. And it's this weird, like, hidden power level to the champion that you have to unlock by understanding the champion.
It was kind of the Lucian problem. When Lucian first came out, everybody was trying different builds. I remember it was very unsuccessful for a very long time until people were like, maybe I should go Trinity Force? Do I go IE first? Mm-hmm. And it was just all this mixture of things. But yes, build paths, definitely, when you figure them out and hash them out, they make the champion stronger, of course, because you find the optimal build.
Right.
But the perception is normally, this champion sucks because you can't figure out what to build.
It's understandable. But either way, Olaf should be building a lot of attack damage. Solo was going for the Black Cleaver build in his games last week, and we are into this one. We do have, by the way, a lane swap scenario. Both supports did jungle with their AD carries. We have Braum actually running aggressively into that right side jungle, trying to find where Hard and Solo would be, but they've already cleared this jungle out. This does mean that Team Imagine knows where Solo is and where Hard is for the most part. They're top left jungle right now.
Solo going to the top lane. This is actually a two-camp push. It's a very kind of emerging strategy. What you do is you wait two waves. You don't wait three because third has the cannon minion in it, but you push the second one all the way to the turret. You pull all off top. He does two camps, not three with the jungler, and then your lanes are still two. So you get up here very quickly, you get your right time,
and you go.
You don't even bring the jungler too. The jungler continues to get level three in the jungle, so he has his power.
Or ganks.
But yeah, exactly.
It unlocks the jungler to make the choice there.
Because the strategy used to be you pull all four people up after they do three camps.
Yep.
Because that's the time when the turret actually has the cannon minion wave on it.
Yep.
But people are prepping it better now.
And this is going to be a perfectly balanced wave. You can see, even though that wave is slightly injured, it'll freeze close enough to the dead turret that it will freeze into Cloud9 Tempest. Meanwhile, Imagine will be pushing it a bit later, but they will knock the turret down in time. There's nothing wrong with killing the turret a little bit slower.
Solo get the freeze.
One thing I do want to point out, though, is neither team got the deep ward down in case there was a defense coming.
Yeah, they all started with the standard wards just across the river and stuff. Nobody got not one.
Well, like, on the second round, though, like,
oh, yeah.
the Janna comes down, puts the trinket down to see if someone's coming to defend the turret. No one did that step. I don't know if they saw the junglers running around, so they knew it wasn't a problem. But typically, when it's executed at a really high level, obviously it didn't get punished here. There was no defense. But typically, I see, actually, one deep ward come down to make sure you see what your opponents are doing.
Like it harass them in the jungle and see?
Yeah, or just literally down the lane to see if someone's trying to
gotcha.
Focus P.
I do like this though, because what they end up doing is they put these wards inside the lanes after they take the turret, right in the middle of it. And this always allows for a TP play if you do decide to collapse or if they do something crazy.
There's no turret to defend you, you get boned.
Exactly.
Super solid. Yeah, I really like this, Irene. Well, we'll see if that can keep happening. Also, Sheep got a couple of nice wards down in the southern jungle as well, so they can pretty easily track Moon on camps.
Yeah, you have to give up these turrets. You can see there was a ward placed in the bottom where
Chunky Fresh is to stand.
Yeah, because there's a he saw the ward come down too.
Man,
has to sacrifice it. Moon
getting pretty wrecked here.
Moon's gonna run into Solo here in the jungle. Doesn't have smite.
He's found from auto attack. Oh no! He misplayed it. The E was still down. Solo, big play there, steals away the giant Krug for like 50 something gold. Now top lane outer still going down to this duel of Imagine. That's going pretty safely. Similar situation for C19.
You're not gonna bounce these waves though. There's way too many minions.
That's
everybody's
true.
Just rushing
They're
these
not,
turrets down.
I think they could keep going though and go for number two. I know Coast hasn't really bought much. Only plus 1080 for the Vamp Scepter, but with Janna in it and tier 2 turret supports don't have that same defensive stat. I think you could make the play. And Solo can still TP down.
If Imagine just bounce this wave, they get a much better wave off this. Yeah.
Unless, again, the outer turret gets pushed. But I don't think it'll happen.
The bottom turret...
I feel like
Baby doesn't have to be here. Baby could have backed.
Yeah, he could have backed sooner.
He'd be fine. They actually hit it too many times.
Yeah, this will be... Actually, it still might
It still freeze. Has a cannon minion in it.
Okay, see, there's the push for bottom tier 2. Yeah, so Baby with a slightly late recall. This could be a pretty solid push. They can still teleport down Olaf if they need him. And wow, Chunky Fresh realizes he's under too much danger.
They're going to try to fight.
This could go really well for Imagine.
I don't know.
They found Moon. Oh no, a bunch of damage.
Moon's
going to run. First blood comes through to Lod. TP for Solo just in case to make sure it's all happy. And that was significantly better played by C9T.
Yep, C9T with the better map movements off the lane swap, forcing them to a decision. They picked the wrong one there. TP down from Solo. They might be able to put some pressure on the turret. There they go!
Over the big play, the body slam flash, and they get him! Solo gets the kill out of the turret, ironically with three teammates help.
And they're gonna get this turret too. Cloud9 Tempest is going to get this bot tier 2 turret, but wait, no, they back off.
They know the recalls came through. They know Corki is back. They
Victor
know
also left
respawn.
Lane.
That's a big one. That's the one I didn't see. So, all right, Imagine just barely defend the turret, but those two kills are still two kills. And yeah, that's what happens. If you do hard push, like, that's the thing, if you expect your opponents to sit under the turret and let the wave bounce and take their time, you can sometimes go for that hard push. C9T did it, and just like we saw at the very beginning of the Coast matchup, their early game plan is just better executed and better strategized, and it was an early game advantage for C9T.
Yeah, 500 extra gold onto Solo and 500 extra gold onto Lod. Big carries for this team.
Oh, yeah.
They're the right people that you want this gold on.
That's a really, really good thing here. Small lane lead as well for Yasui, just kind of like we expected. C9T are doing a great job in the laning phase. Even though a lot of it is lane swap banded.
Yeah. Lulu, I think, is actually very good in lane swaps because she's almost never going to lose the lane, regardless of who she's against. She's also a little bit of a bully against some mids that are one tier down from like Victor or Nazir. And another thing on top of that is even if she does get bullied out, she's always relevant. She's always just going to be able to show up to the fight, give her movement speed, and that's fine. But Mancloud was pulled out of the lane for a couple seconds multiple times. I saw him actually leave lane a little bit. Fake down, fake up, and he lost some CS over time. So if Yasui was just picking up the CS that he wasn't, it slowly but surely amounted to this lead.
Yeah. The easy way to locate that actually is look at the experience on both these players. Granted, Yasui got like a blue buff here, but he was actually pretty significantly ahead XP-wise, even leading up to the blue buff getting taken. So you're right, Mancloud wasn't there, I believe, for a couple of minions in the overall scenario. Not too many, of course, it wasn't a big difference, but...
Up to 11 in CS difference, though.
Yep. Now that Sentinel will die off. 10 gold for Steel Bath. Oh, can take plenty of damage. No one's around to defend it. Of course, bot lane got pushed so deeply in that they had to go knock down minion waves, and it goes to a match.
But that's the Scuttlecrab of C9T. They see this happening, and Hard goes for the blue buff on the opposite side of the map.
Solid.
So this is a little bit of an advantage, if it's not taken away. There we go. For Yasui as well, because he has the blue buff to Mancloud, not having that, and not having the experience, too. So it's not only just the fact he gets the mana regen and cooldown, it's the EXP.
Yep, first level 9, that's always important. But we're at a state now. Mancloud is level 7 with the augment. He will one-shot caster minions, but does not have that same mana pool that might make things a bit easier. We'll see if it pans out to be difficult. But Mancloud basically has guaranteed 4 CS per wave, regardless of the state of his opponent's champion.
It's also a very strange Victor Summoner spell, taking a heal in the mid lane against an Ignite on a Lulu. So I assume what it's for is later
it's
in the game.
It's heal or barrier.
Yeah.
It's usually the choice.
For Victors, usually you can get an Ignite too if you're looking for the kill pressure in lane.
Mm.
But I feel like this is for the Olaf later. This is for when the Olaf runs at you, tries to kill you.
Mm-hmm. Move speed's definitely valuable there. All right, well, fan vote right now does go slightly in the favor of Team Imagine based on seeding. Based on their earlier matchup, you would expect so as well. If I remember correctly, Imagine did 2-0 when these guys met earlier on in the split. Cloud and Tempest, we mentioned it in the semifinal, actually. They had been boot camping for a while at the C9 compound, and their early games definitely show it.
Yeah, and looking at just past records, Imagine, they were 2-1 against Renegades, ended up losing that set. Cloud9 ended up going 2-0 down against Coast.
Yeah.
So, looking at the history, looking at where these guys finished, Imagine finished third, Cloud9 Tempest finished fourth, but it looks like the boot camp and the level one and the strategies that they're getting fed from Charlie seem to be helping them out. And Imagine, you know, this has always been Imagine's bane. Their early game and their laning always seems to fall short. They average about 1,000 gold down at 15 minutes, and then they have to compensate that through team fights later in the game.
Mm-hmm.
But C9T have a very good team fighting comp.
Yeah, as long as Olaf gets this money. And right now, he's sitting on 2,800 gold. He's actually right now, Solo has the least money on his team that's not a support. So if it's focused around him, and it, to be honest, kind of is, he's actually a little bit behind the curve here.
Yeah.
In the way, he'll get some here, right? But it feels like with Moon and Zubak, or Chunker trying to mess with them, honestly, Imagine doing a decent job of holding Solo down, despite that kill he got earlier.
Yeah, he was also up in CS. He had at one point, I think, double. It was something like 17 to 8 CS. But then they put Chunky Fresh in the frozen lane on the tier 2. And over time, over about 3-4 waves, he's been pushing it slowly in the top lane, all the way from his tier 2 to the tier 2 of Solo. And that's always very scary as a top laner, because you need to pull your jungler, you need to pull people's attention. Because if there are 3 people show up top, and they dive you under that turret, you're dead. You will lose all the experience. Even if they trade 1-for-1 in kills, they
you
still
lost all the XP.
Yeah,
and gold
all
the
that experience is gone. It's a top laner's nightmare when there's a huge wave.
Yeah,
you just want it, but you can't overextend for it.
Of course not. And just to flesh out the point I was talking earlier about the gold from Solo, even after that wave he cleared, he was still behind Hard, Lod, and Yasui in gold. So he is getting denied a fair bit of farm. You can see 53 CS to 91, big disparity despite the kill he's got. So Team Imagine now, what can they do, right? You talked about the fact that they're typically down early on in the game. They're, you know, on course for that one, actually maybe a bit worse than average, to be fair. But we still see these guys make comebacks. We'll see if that happens here later on with their shot calling. But looking at the state of the game, Ruin King's already done here for Lod's Ballista. Teleport coming in, they're going for the play.
I don't know, this is risky.
Really good knockback. Chucky Fresh has to run away, maybe gonna buy some time, but now they can focus down on the support. Moved at a half as well, and CNT reacting very, very quickly. Well played by them, stymieing the aggression. All 5 now bot lane, nothing to be done here. Lulu could just push back in.
Gotta watch out for this. If Moon checks
Wow,
in.
They knew exactly what brush he was in. That was so smart. Can you imagine, saw Yasui had come down. They actually guessed where he was sitting, and they were correct there. So Magic takes the long way around. See, this is actually the interesting thing, is actually, hold on, we're gonna go for the siege first. Hold on, whoops, misclick. I want to talk about mid laners at some point, following versus pushing in mid, and what ends up being the right choice. And a lot of times you'll see really good mid laners will not respond to the roam, and just be like, he's roaming, leave, and get half the turret dead.
Yeah, that's if your team makes the executive decision of, we are not going to fight this,
yes,
we're just going to pull them down. But you also have to keep them interested enough to pull the the mid laner all the way down. Because if you walk back too fast, he goes back to the lane. He only misses about 2 CS. So it's this weird kind of dance where the mid laner and the bottom and the other four-man unit have to have good synergy.
Absolutely.
And communication.
Yep. This just ended up being a case where Yasui probably could have stayed mid and denied a wave and ended up looking for a play that didn't happen. Really, really small thing, right? I'm not even saying it was wrong objectively, but the way it panned out ended up being you would be better sitting in the wave. Just, I like pointing out really small things, especially when games end up being a little bit slower paced. Sometimes staying in your lane is actually the right choice.
I like it. Challenger can be a little bit of a, you know, teaching lesson too.
I do like doing that sometimes. So, Steelback getting closer and closer to Triforce. He's actually got the money for it when he recalls. That's a big deal. Level 9 entry Triforce. Really, really nice on this Corki here.
Very curious about Lod's build though. Went for the Blade of the Rune King first. BT, you know, is not as effective on her since the nerf. It's still very good. And then people went Ruinance Hurricane first sometimes, but that seems to be splitting the difference between the two.
Yeah. I don't really feel like I've found out the reason why people do different builds. I've talked with players like Sneaky about it, and he's like, yeah, I just like did a different build and it felt good, so I just did it. Like, no one ever seems to do the math behind it. It's just not how people are inclined. And I haven't seemed to find a compelling reason to for any of the builds. I feel like they're all equivalent. Or close enough to equivalent. This will give him kiting potential. Chunky Fresh and Moon trying to dive him and better getting away from them.
Some good dueling too.
Yeah, I mean it's better in that regard. As long as you're not getting bursted out, Bloodthirster is more health, more durability. And as long as you're worrying about kiting more than getting bursted, then Ruin King is at least directionally better. He's also got bonus attack damage already from Janna.
It helps you kill neutral monsters better.
It does make you better.
Boom!
Actually, I think one of the big ones is the synergy she has with Janna. You already have attack damage, so get other stats.
Nice. I like that. Get the lifesteal for the laning phase.
Well, you get vamp anyway.
And
but
vamp.
Doing the attack speed build, I can see it being a specific Janna thing. If you're going to find
getting both is what I was
doing. Right. Okay,
lifesteal and the attack speed.
Yep. Yeah.
I like
okay.
it.
Now we're on the same page, because you were talking about Hurricane build still. I haven't seen Hurricane Rush in a long time.
Yeah, ever since people started going with, some people were like, IE first!
Month or two.
Bloodthirster first!
I'm still okay with BT ship as a build.
Yeah.
I think it's weaker since the changes. But, I don't know, I never got to play it, really. Alright, mid lane easily cleared. Honestly, sieging against Corki plus Victor, fat chance, guys. C9T cannot make this kind of play. They can hope for the out rotation, they can hope, imagine misses. It only costs you 10 seconds to check for that. I can't say it's objectively wrong. Yet again, talking about kind of the difficulty of shot calling. Oh,
Moon.
Didn't see the burst coming. Stole blue away from Mancloud.
That's the second blue that Mancloud has missed out on.
Yeah.
He's below half mana. And this is the thing about Victor, is you don't invest in a mana regen item.
Yeah. You at least get a bunch of flat mana from the item he has himself. It's plus 300 for him right now. So that's not terrible. But blue buff gives you regen based on max mana. That's why this build works out, is you just... Blue gives you all the regen you need, so Mancloud can oom.
And he went CDR build, too, so he has the ability to throw out a lot of spells and drain his mana pool and put a lot of pressure on himself.
Yeah. It's definitely a big deal. We'll see if he gets punished for that one. If he ooms the next fight, in the next minute and a half, we'll know why. A lot of easy scuttle take on the bot side. But honestly, it feels like the lanes are getting in a state where Imagine are getting back in. Nothing's really died in a long time, and the gold is back to 500 when it was 1,500 apart.
Yeah, Solo doesn't have a way to push top lane out, so Chunky Fresh has been freezing extraordinarily well in the bot, in the top lane and near his tier 2 for a long time.
And Steelback's remained up about 20 as well. This has actually been that margin has been the same for a while here. Mancloud, plus or minus 6, really not a big problem here. You look at Moon versus Hard, and despite the fact that Hard is 2 assists, Moon's got the same gold as him. So farm-wise, in the mid-game, as the lanes pan out, Imagine actually doing a much better job of acquiring gold. That's a really big deal for these guys.
Let's see what they can do with their map movements. The acquisition of Steelback did a lot for their late-game shot calling and their mid-game shot calling.
Mm-hmm.
It also helped them a lot in level 1s. This was a team that had a roster that was just switching all throughout the season.
Yeah.
They really, really, really want to make it to promotion tournament because they'll have even more time to solidify, steal back in the roster, get everybody on the same page. And Moon is a guy that's constantly improving, and if you give him more time, then I'm sure he's going to come out swinging in the promotion tournament if they make it there. But they just have to get through C9T to make it that far. And C9T, they want to make LCS. These guys have been around for a good while. How many times has Lod been so close? That guy was in promo tournament at one point, I believe.
Yeah.
That Zed back door.
Gosh, poor guy. He's a really good player too, of course. Laude's definitely an excellent.
Yeah, he went to London. I remember.
Yep.
It's a London roadshow.
He's a great mid laner and a great AD carry, at least for the challenger scene. We'll see if he can get that one step farther. The game slipping away right now from Cloud and Tempest, though still a lead for them. Attempting to siege top tier two. But yet again, Imagine are here in time. There's going to be no damage. Baby puts up the shield.
Still
doesn't even
bot.
Take damage. But who cares? C-Max getting farmed. That's totally fine for Imagine. They're just getting more golden XP. Now it's a 300 gold lead.
Yep. Just have Victor walk up. Clear the wave, and you're
good. With a Braum shield, which is actually a really big deal as well, because sometimes you can get like 500 damage in. And C9T now wrapping around behind the turret. This is a bit risky. They're taking some damage. They can't really fight back. To be fair, the Braum ulti misses. Nothing is done, but C9T are trying so hard to knock turrets down with what to me feels honestly a bit mid-game focused of a team composition, just when Lulu exists that ends up being a bit mid-game focused. And they're not getting much headway. They're trying one more time. Five mid. Heckerman not here yet. Baby puts up the shield, and Victor wave clears.
Nope, you're not going to be able to siege
CNT
this.
CNT can't win this way.
You can't siege this. I love the Braum pick, and I like the Victor being able to clear out the waves instantaneously. Mm-hmm. C9T, if they keep doing what they're doing, Imagine's just slowly going to take a gold lead over them because C9T are not catching waves. You see Chunky Fresh? He's back at it again. He's freezing the top lane. Every time Chunky Fresh has an ability to get farm, he sits there, slowly CSs it, slowly pushes it out, because that forces Solo to have to get ward control before he even goes to that wave. And even if he gets ward control, it's an Evelynn.
That's true. I think at this point, though, with now he's got Ninja Tabby and a Black Cleaver, I feel like Solo is probably fine against Chunky Fresh Moon. Just trade ults, and if you have to go straight away, do so. I expect Solo to be reasonably okay. With Red Buff, that might change. We can see maybe that turns around at some point here. I'm just unsure, honestly. I haven't seen this matchup play out too many times. But that could be one to watch for, though. If that top lane matchup ends up getting one-sided, it means so much for the game. Because right now, C9T, they've been trying to siege, but they have no way to dictate where their opponents go, except for just sending five people. And Imagine's wards are good enough, they just see him walk over, and they show up in time. If Solo is actually able to pull attention because he beats Chunky Fresh, then you can't do that anymore. And Braum and Victor can't be there clearing the wave and blocking all the damage output. And this siege that CNT keeps trying will eventually work.
Yeah, next dragon in about 30 seconds. Chunky Fresh, I don't believe he won't have Trinity Force by then. So it's actually a big spike for Solo over Chunky.
Ooh.
They both have TPs. If they're both in the top lane and they show up, you might see some kills falling over to either of those top laners until in that matchup. Chunky Fresh, though, like I said, no Trinity Force for this fight.
There's a difference in home guards, though, which could be a very big deal. The types of plays Hecarim's allowed to are more numerous because of that utility buy he went for. Maybe something happens. It's going to be a hard one to watch for. Corki's already shoved out bottom. He's going back to join his team near mid. Snanty, though, are well on their way. They're already here. They've already got the ward control. This is going to be a difficult stop for Imagine.
Chunky's backing for the TP, for the home guard.
But the wards are gone. There's one down to the bottom right.
He's going to go from the minions to the bot side. He's going for the minions to the bot.
Okay, here he goes. The ulti comes in from Braum. They want to knock down Solo. He ults out, takes
there
the
he is.
And here's the push on in. He chooses to go for the Olaf. Gets the fear onto four of them. It's a slaughter right now. Team Imagine pushing in 3-for-1 so far. Moon kiting in towards Laude. Laude can't do enough here. Ren's already on cooldown. Four kills picked up. Yasui chased in to do some damage. Was forced to flash away because of that one. Good flank. There's the home guard paying off.
Every time I talk about Chunky Fresh, it's his Sion or his Hecarim, because this guy, he might fall behind in lane, he might not have a good game, but when he gets the engage, you sit there going, how did the other team let that happen? But it's because Chunky Fresh comes from strange places and he's communicating with his team about where they should focus them, where they should push them towards. And it's just so well played. He comes from the bottom and Baby is putting on so much pressure. C9T would actually have to shove into all of Imagine and burst them before Chunky Fresh got there. But you can see by their positioning, they were just spread. Such a good fear there. Oh,
I believe.
God.
It might have been five. I don't know.
That looked like
Yasui
four. I didn't account for Yasui. It doesn't matter, though.
Yeah,
they pick up everybody here.
That was actually really big, too. The Flash Braum ulti made Solo pop Olaf ult to get out of the knockup. And then Chunky Fresh, he actually, his charge was on Janna, actually. And then when the Olaf ult timed out, he just point-blank Fear, then also so pushed good. Solo into his team, CC'd, and was killed.
It's so funny, too, because when I look at those ultimates, Sion ultimate, Hecarim ultimate, I'm always sitting there like, okay, I need to use it from a distance. Chunky Fresh is not afraid to use them point-blank.
It's basically Galio ult. He might as well play Homeguard Galio.
I remember that Sion game where he's just walking through the bot side jungle. There's three people in the red bush, and he's like, oh, I'm right next to them. Boom. Three-man knock-up into another knock-up.
Yep.
Chunky Fresh is really good at waiting for those types of opportunities. He doesn't force them. He doesn't overextend for them. And that's how he got his Trinity Force. The story's over.
Wonderful. Well, just enough money now for him. Life is good. TP is still up for solo. I don't know if there's really much C9 can do to make a play around that teleport, but it exists.
And this is the same thing that happened to C9T against Coast in game one. They had a really good level one. They played it out well. They got an advantage. Then the advantage slowly went away, and a team fight happened, and they lost it. And then just the momentum was entirely in the other team's favor. And C9T playing from behind mid-game, late-game, has always been a problem because they go for those aggressive plays. Get Dragon, get Baron, when they have it set up for them completely.
You know what I really liked, by the way, is the more I think about this, like that fight was won because of the Homeguard Hecarim, of course. Like, I think we're all on the same page in that one. What I found interesting is there was a ward in the brush just to the right of Dragon, like between the lane and between Dragon, that little tiny brush that everyone knows. He chose not to TP there, but the one in the lane. Now, the thing is, that distance is not very big when you're a Homeguard charging Hecarim. He wanted to make sure they didn't see him teleport, I think. Or, like, they couldn't land a Glitter Lance on his way in. He, like, I feel like that's the reason, right? Just, like, him having the room to play around the engage window felt like the choice he was making. And it was really smart, because I was like, oh, just TP to that ward. And he goes to the lane, and I was like, I don't understand why. And then it plays out really well. It's a really minor point, but it really intrigued me.
I didn't end up seeing that ward push.
I scrolled down on my computer. Oh, okay. Was definitely there.
Nice. But I like the idea of Gum coming from the bottom lane.
Yeah.
Running straight up, because it put Lod in a terrible position.
Yeah.
Gives you less time to react to the actual TP. You'd have to be watching your minimap very closely when
you're dodging a
exactly,
freaking
that's not
Braum
what people
ultimate.
Do. You're dodging a Braum ultimate.
Yeah.
And actually give mad props to Baby too for that Braum ultimate across the opening of the dragon.
Someone just yelled engage and he's like, all right, F it, I guess I will.
Chunky Fresh in the bot lane. Go. And they pinged it too. They pinged it ahead of time that he's coming to the minions. It was a play that they set up a little bit before. I really liked it. And that's going to be a huge play here for the entire game, because it just tipped the scales in their favor very heavily.
Imagine her winning now, and we'll see if Phantom Chemist gets their way back in on this one. It'll be difficult, but maybe it does happen.
Runan.
Mid lane just playing the wave through game back and forth. Yep, Runan's Hurricane being done for a lot is a big deal. Talisman of Ascension done for Sheep, also quite nice. He made the unfortunate choice of going for Spell Feast and being in a lane swap, so it didn't mean anything. And had to drop the sunk cost of selling it and buying a new GP10. But all is well. Sheep is my favorite support item in the game.
Sheep is your favorite support item?
Has my favorite support item.
I thought you said is.
Yes. Ah. If you could just hex people, that would be great. Just sheep them as a support item. Not in this game. There are no hard CC items that I can remember.
Distortion. Well, Zhonya is your hard CC herself.
That doesn't.
Boom! Anyway. Oh,
whatever. Who's got distortion?
Distortion onto hard.
Oh, weird.
For the flash body slam cooldown.
That's an interesting choice. I don't know if I agree with it, but I guess if he lands some really good flashes, then I'm happy about it.
I think Jat and I were having a conversation about this when Gragas was really, really popular. It was Gragas Sejuani back and forth, back and forth. It's like, maybe rushing distortion's a good idea.
Oh,
we're going to talk about
Yusui.
That in a second. Moon.
Going to get jumped on, slowed down. He's saving the ulti. Doesn't even pop it. Chilling Smite he thought was enough, and Yusui with the knockout gets away.
Yeah, it's so hard to get a Lulu anyway. Two shields, movement speed increase, way to change you into something that's ineffective.
Max, that's going Lich Bane. This is interesting.
I like that build. I really do like that build.
Really bursty. Deathcap Lich Bane is exciting.
Exciting.
Because it's a very different dynamic, right? He has to auto. He has to land Qs.
Yeah.
It changes the dynamic of that champion significantly.
They don't have any super long-range poke. People have to be in your face anyway on this team. Olaf will be in your face. Kalista will be 500 units away. Same thing with Lulu for the most part.
I mean, just really doubling down on your mid-range power is totally fine. Like, I really like Death Cap early on Victor as well. I think it's not bought early enough oftentimes. So I'm glad to see Manfred buying this one.
And it's synergy with hex cores being.
Well, that's exactly why, honestly, is raw AP is better than normal on this champion.
Yeah, you're looking at about 490 AP, and then Yasui's on 345.
Yep. And they have, like, almost the same gold. They're off by 300, and the difference in AP is massive. Well, moderate.
It's got about 25% more AP.
Pretty solid. All right, Mancloud gets his blue buff.
Finally.
LCS big plays. Mancloud's got mana regen. Just playing the wave clear game, though. All really Imagine has done is just show up to that one team fight, get a 4-for-1, and then wait around some more here. It's honestly been pretty slow going. Imagine haven't tried to make almost any aggressive moves whatsoever.
Playing around dragon spawn time seems to be the name of the game. Imagine could get their third here. But C9T, I think they've been to at every dragon pretty early setting it up. There was that one.
The first one was given away to Imagine when they stole blue buff for it, which is
they
fine.
Traded it away. But then since then, C9T have always just been getting to the dragon first. But right now, I like this. Imagine shove out the mid lane, put the threat of possibly having that happen. And here we are. 6 minutes later, Chunky Fresh's TP's back up. There's another play that can be made. And now C9T have complete control of Baron. But I don't know. They did this before against Coast. This is an aggressive call. We talked about
that. Again, Blue Trigger used as well. C9T can't really stay, but they're not taking much damage. They got time here. It's fine. Mood should be back in the game already.
Yeah, he is. He's moving around.
Yep. It was a under-the-broadcast pause. Play Challenger games on a delay and just...
Don't
tell pauses happen at a different time. Oh, that's true. I think it's widely known, actually.
Yeah, it's actually good, because then that... We never have to fill. Remember when we had to fill?
Yep. Less anyway. Of that here. All right, well, when's the gravity field coming up? Imagine actually delaying on their zoning tools
turret's
here.
Turret's gone.
Gonna get knocked up. The turret's not dead yet. The heart comes in. They finally zone him out here. Jumping across the wall, trying to run away. Chunky Fresh just barely lives. He did not need the heal, actually. They should have timed the ignite. Chunky Fresh should have known he was safe. It's okay. Steelback pops in anyway, and they just run away gallantly. But mid lane getting fired out there. It's going to be a quick pickup for C9T.
No ultimate on Chunky Fresh, so if he TPs in, it's still not as big of a threat as it was before. Had to blow that as an escape.
And C9T is still trying. Chunky Fresh, though, has teleport, has home guard, has his ulti. No, doesn't have his ulti. I take that back.
Yep.
But just some damage done. C9T forced to run away here, but successful fight and a successful turret kill.
Yeah.
Baron bait worked out. Solid.
One for one in turret kills in that. They ended up getting the turret mid.
Oh, you're right.
It fell down to minions after they had retreated. So overall, it's just a one for one. But local gold doesn't go over to C9T. They had ran away. That's to Imagine. They had run away from the turret.
I think total gold earned technically goes C9T's way. But however, on the back foot of that, over aggressive for mid tier two, they took too much damage, had to give away map control to give Dragon over to Team Imagine. I think the Baron bait was a good choice, but the follow-up just slightly underwhelming.
It's a scary choice.
Of course it is.
It's extremely
I think
scary
it was
choice.
Correct in that choice in that case, though. We talked about, I think part of the reason I'm talking about this is our opening to C9T was, if you make shot calls that half the time fail miserably and half the time are good, it just means you're just taking risky calls all the time without understanding their merits. In these cases, I actually think like that choice was good, but it didn't play out well enough. And sort of like keeping that threat alive in my mind and trying to grade each of these, I'm actually so far fairly okay with C9T's choice.
What would you give that one?
I mean, it was fine. Like I would say it was correct. Like, I think it's hard to be like, is there a better choice out there somewhere in League of Legends?
I thought you were going to grade them. You going to give it a B?
I'm doing pass-fail.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
I'm taking one of those courses you're just getting to get units.
Oh, it's, man.
It's like when you get one of those really hard courses where you know you're not going to get an A.
Freak
you
want to
keep your GPA
league.
Up.
You pass or you fail. You know, it's pass-fail.
No, it's up to you. You know, you can take some pass-fail. You can take some graded.
I don't have to take your course. I just don't like the way you grade it.
Yeah.
Pass
my grading system?
Pass.
I grade on curve.
Pass with like 60%.
I'm grading on curve. All right.
On curve?
Yeah, on a curve.
Actually, that is kind of how League of Legends works.
How could you not?
Cross region.
You have to understand how everyone else plays, and this is hard to think that far in the future. As we get ourselves into the game here, Dragon, of course, is gone, though, and it's not a whole lot to play for right now.
Yeah.
Moon, though, is getting a lot more farm. He's pushing the bot lane by himself. They're starting to give him a lot more of this money. His Rylai's is done pretty soon. Now, actually.
Rylai's. I like 2 AP items on Evelynn now, possibly 3 depending on how offensive you're actually going to get with your build. He did go with the Ninja Tabi.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure that he can reduce some of the damage.
Yeah.
I think it'll be a defensive build from here.
I think it's interesting as well seeing the distributions of money. when we were watching LCS this last weekend, jungle top, AD carry, mid were all actually very close together. They're within 1,000 of each other. But here you've actually got a 3,000 gold disparity between Hard and Yasui, and actually an over 3,000 gold disparity between Moon and Mancloud. It's actually a much more lopsided gold distribution this game. But we're getting ourselves into the battles once again. Sheep forced to hold himself out.
Nope. Here comes Chunky Fresh.
This is going to be pretty dangerous. Only hits Hard. Flashes, goes in, looks for Sheep. Oh. Who gets all the way, but Law just gets evaporated. Mancloud doing big damage. Sheep's going to go down too. A double kill for the mid laner. The trade for Chunky Fresh, but Solo is not in the best spot. Gets a lot of spells.
That extra movement speed from the Whimsy there.
Big deal.
Got him out. Chunky Fresh sacrifices himself for a lot of engagements. Was, once again, another good engagement here. They actually do this Baron. They have their jungler. They have their smite available.
This is scary, though. Hard has flash in 7 seconds, and he's got smite. This could be...
There's a ward in the pit. Just got to clear it behind the Baron.
They have no way of zoning him out, though. Oh, he's going to lose some health.
Oh, don't stand behind it.
This is scary. Oh. Okay, Steelback goes in to fight Hard. He pushed them out.
It's so weak.
But they don't have the damage to kill it. Mancloud is a tank. Oh, no. No one gets Baron. Oh, no. And Steelback's got to be careful. Solo does some big damage here.
Steelback went over the wall, and then it's just Moon and Baby left in the pit.
I don't know where Mancloud was, if he was Ooze or something, but...
That's so low.
I think Steelback was the only guy who could have stopped that, though. I think he made the right choice as well.
Yeah.
I would not give a 50-50 Baron away. I would just not let that happen if you're already winning as Imagine. So I think Steelback did the right choice, but I think he didn't have enough team around to finish the Baron off.
Pass again. I like that. Over the wall for Mancloud.
Super good.
Oh, and it actually put Sheep in a terrible place too when he got Fate's Call right as he died. Oh, just barely Solo makes it out. Just
Sheep flashed too. That was unnecessary.
Yeah, he got Fate's Call backwards into Lod, who just got annihilated. And then
Sheep
he was
could have left.
He's put in a worse place.
Well, you just press right click. I think you can still jettison from a corpse.
Yeah, you can. He just didn't go far enough.
Silly Sheep.
Yeah. Oh well. Blows his flash, ends up dying anyway. Imagine still in the lead by 1,000 gold. They didn't get much for the Baron Force, but they didn't give up anything for it either. You see,
yeah, true.
See Yasui, he's going for the offensive build here. CDR, of course, with the boots, so that you get the movement speed and the shield more often. But the loot Zekko to actually be a damage threat.
I actually have a question on that one if we're not going to get in a fight.
What's up?
Quick. What would you consider the non-damage third item here?
Some people end up going for, like, Zhonya's, right? Because Loot Zekko just gives you that extra burst. Zhonya's is more defensive option.
I mean, they cost the same, though, right? I guess for not dying as opposed to, like... I was thinking, like, how else would you get more utility? Because, like, AP is the only way you get utility in the champion.
Yeah.
I see what you're going for, though. Okay, I get it. Yeah, Zhonya's would be a defensive option to not get killed yourself, and you wouldn't have to ult or shield yourself as much.
Yeah.
So, okay, I feel you. Yeah, I get what you're going for. Just curious.
Go for a Rylan.
Oh, Moon's gonna find somebody. The Rylan's here. On. Goodbye. Holy cow. Hard takes a bit of pain as well. He's got a flash away from that one. Shorter cooldown takes a distortion, but gets wrecked all the same. Good pick.
Oh, man. Lod is just out of position a lot. He hasn't been able to blow his heal in the last two fights where he's died. He just gets destroyed right very, very quickly. Everybody just dives in and he can't get out.
Yeah, just... They're not quite respecting the Evelynn enough. And the thing is, because it's gone Rylai's, Moon doesn't have to use the ult for these picks. Like, normally she has no CC, and it's so hard. You have to ult and hope it's enough.
Yeah, she just runs around spamming Q. 20% slow.
Shouldn't it be 40? It's just an AoE. It's not a multi hit. Or is it? I guess it kind of... No, it's just an AoE.
It's just an AoE.
Yeah. I mean, it would have to be a dot. To not be a 20... to not be a 40% slow.
Yeah.
God, that's so ridiculous.
I don't know why I was thinking Elise, because Elise gets 20% slow from her minions when she has it.
The minions apply that?
They should.
Really?
I would assume so.
I don't think they apply spell effect.
Pets.
Oh, you're right. We did the pets change. All right. Well, Dragon goes over fourth of the game for Imagine here. They are 6 minutes away from Aspect. Baron, of course, is perennially on the field, though. It's been difficult to take for both these sides. But slowly and surely, Imagine playing to get these objectives, and they're picking them up.
One dragon away from that Dragon 5. 6 minutes from now, they have that win condition on the table. But so far, they've been winning the majority of these team fights, these skirmishes, these picks.
Mm-hmm.
And C9T, honestly, when you look around and you look at these last few plays, you're like, where was Solo? Why weren't they forcing something? They fell back. Now, they're forcing an objective here. Chunky Fresh opposite side of the map. needs to start backing now if he wants the home guard, but he's not going to go. He's going to go straight for the TP here. And we're going to have a fight.
A lot of damage put on, and Sheep's going to be in a really bad spot. Ults in, then gets ulted out. He's going to look for solo going down, though, one for nothing. They're going for the second chase is here, and Lot's going to lose his life. Three kills picked up already. Imagine cannot lose a team fight.
It seems like they can't at all. They're going to get this Baron right after that, too. Chunky Fresh is trying to zone out hard, make sure that there's no way he can get in here. Maybe, though, it's still stealable.
Steelback wants in again to stop him, flashes over the wall to do so, but it's enough to get Hard away from this fight. He cannot stop this Baron now. Very smart choice being made there. Baron goes over to Team Imagine. Really solid.
I really like that. As a jungler, I just hate it when somebody doesn't jump out of the pit and stop the guy.
What steal would you give him?
Oh, I would give that an A+ right there. I'd give that an A+. School of Zyrene. Normally people think you have to send the hard CC guy after him. We'll talk about that in a second.
Just kill
him. Oh, man.
Just dies so
dive
fast.
Into it. Chunky Fresh hasn't even used his ultimate yet. He gets to use it here.
You didn't ult Olaf either? Yeah. Oh, God.
Ended up ultiing for the attempted save there. But yeah. Normally, you think you have to send the disengage, the Alistar headbutt over the wall, the Gragas barrel to, like, knock the person away. But Hard of CC is killing somebody.
Yeah.
So just send the kill threat after
the best
them.
CC.
They got it down to about 2,000 HP, and then he jumped over the wall.
Oh, Hard.
Oh, boy. Oh, he's going to get kicked down.
Wow, really solid. Ward over the wall to make sure Mancloud could aim the ulti properly. Takes him out. Imagine, so far ahead now, 5,500 gold up. They've got Baron. They've even got Dragon in their back pocket in about 4 minutes. It's a solid game now in the mid game and on beyond from Team Imagine.
They hit their double trendy forces. Ooh. They know that they're able to push down these objectives and they start doing Fate's Call.
I don't know if he meant to hit that. I'm pretty sure he didn't.
Oh, man. Just the siege is completely in favor of Imagine at the moment. They've had it all game, too.
Oh, wow. That poke was. Feels so bad.
Wrong. The Victor clearing these waves. Look at that. Double trendy force shreds the turret and the Lich Bane.
Oh, yeah. These objectives are completely done here. All right. So bigger lead, 6,000 up. Can you imagine? Knocked on the first inhibitor. Bot lane tier 2 is basically free at this point.
When you're able to get through the early game as Imagine, the problems that they're seeing in their gameplay typically stem from the early game.
Yep.
But it's just a mismatch here. Cloud9 Tempest has a good early game. Imagine has a bad one. But Cloud9 Tempest.
Don't transition.
There you go. Their mid-game calls versus Imagine's mid-game calls. Honestly, C19 need a larger advantage if they want to walk away with a victory in this entire series. Because Imagine, they're just showing that if you win early, they don't care. They're going to beat you with teamfight coordination later on in the game.
That's the funny thing about getting an early lead off the lane swap is there's no turrets left to kill. And CNT tried, right? They tried to siege. They made aggressive choices. This is never the problem. They're not trying to do things. The problem is trying to do the right things, and they never were able to do that. They didn't keep the blue buff steals going for long enough. The second blue of, like, Mancloud's second blue was just accidentally taken by Moon. It wasn't even pressured. It was still where there was a gold lead. CNT looked for turrets, and to Imagine's credit, they got there in time.
Oh, yeah.
You can't think you can siege against Victor Braum.
You just don't. Frustrating.
You just don't, though.
It's frustrating.
I know.
You see it happen.
And you bash your head into those comps for a while, and you learn, okay, I can't knock these turrets down. I have to find the other thing to shot call for. We'll play for a different objective because the turrets aren't it. And it's tough to learn what those things are and how to set them up properly, but CNT unfortunately not finding the right things to go for.
And they're going to have to defend a dragon in a minute and 30 seconds with an inhib down middle.
Yeah.
Fifth dragon for Imagine. Ever since they got Steelback, they won those last four games, put themselves at third place, and split the series with Renegades, which was considered a tournament favorite.
Yeah.
I think near the beginning of the season, everybody was saying, you know, C9T, Coast, Renegades.
Dogs. Yep.
People didn't know what order they were in, but they were assuming those were the top three. Imagine the team that made it in off of Fusion not keeping their spot, had to play the third, fourth place match to even get into Challenger. And now they're playing a third, fourth place match to see if they get to compete in the LCS, or at least for the promotion tournament.
And in Spring Split, they'll play a third, fourth place match in the LCS playoff!
Boom!
That's a bit forward thinking.
No.
And yeah, to add his credit though, they played their first 2 weeks on an almost entirely different roster. The only remaining player from week two is Chunky Fresh. Dardock, Wolfie, Massacre, Ray, Indivisible, all replaced here down the line. Moon, Mancloud, Steelback, Baby, doing a great job here, looking like a solid team in Challenger overall. And we'll see if they can close this one out. 42 minutes in. Taking their time, certainly. Had to come back from a deficit.
Looking for a force here. It's Fifth Dragon in 10 seconds. And Hard just took about one-third of his HP, so he's down to two-thirds. TP from behind.
Looks for the play. Nobody's
there!
Cloud. A lot of damage, but Hard has no teammates at all. They got gummed up by the TP flank from Chunky Fresh. Solo's gone as well. This Olaf not getting a chance to do anything. A double kill for Mancloud. Into the mid lane they go. Ride the dead inhibitor. This could be the game-winning
push.
Yeah,
screw Fifth Dragon. Just go for the victory here. They're going to push with all five members. It's just a Lulu and a Janna. It is a bit of their wave clear, but they're still very tanky. They might just decide to tank this out and kill a turret.
I think you can backdoor these turrets right here. You've got a blue elixir already on Mancloud. He does bonus damage. Plenty of AP as well. Juggling the aggro quite well. That is going to be it. There is no chance now for Cloud9 Tempest. Took him 43 minutes, but game one goes to Team Imagine. They are a nexus away from the promo tournament.
And they're showing that their team fight is what ends up getting them through.
Yep.
Honestly, MVP of that game has got to be Chunky Fresh for me. The TP flank in the first fight
that
gave him the advantage. And then the second fight, same story. Was able to get on priority targets every single time.
Yep.
Huge credit to him. And the runner-up is kind of Baby, the guy that's always under the... under the radar, the way that he was able to kind of play with Chunky Fresh, and that synergy seemed to work out for them very well this game.
Yeah, honestly, very solid. Baby 2-0-8. In fact, more than half the team went deathless. The bottom lane and mid lane all combined. Zero deaths for Team Imagine here. And this was Team Imagine playing every single Team Imagine game you imagine, like you can think of. I didn't even mean to go for the double word there, but it's their early laning, a little bit rough. Damage comes through from the big damage dealers, and, you know, Chunky Fresh lands the team fight engage.
It's so strange, too, because I'm looking at the post-game damage, and Chunky Fresh only did 6,800.
Yeah.
He did less than Moon. He's the fourth highest damage on his team. He's only about 2,000 damage ahead of the support.
Yeah.
But he's still the guy who had that huge impact. His stats don't really show it. His kill participation's rather low. His KDA, his CSD, but it's those engages. It's those things you can't measure with the statistics.
I mean, he was 11 of 14, which, you're right, is actually lower than everyone not named Braum, but still, like... that's the thing is he was never in a heads-up battle against Olaf. He never laned, like, truly laned against solo. He just got his farm. You were talking about the slow pushes. He was accruing as much gold as he can without being in combat. Then when it finally did get pushed in, he would just go somewhere else. That was just very solid lane play by Chunky Fresh overall. Very avoidance focus, which I think was very smart. You're right. Very good ultimates. Flip it to C9T, I want to see an entirely different style.
Yeah.
The choice of Olaf was smart. Trying to play a split-pushing style, trying to abuse Chunky Fresh's weaker laning phase, and the fact that he relies on teamfight prowess above all else to be a good player. And yet they never played around the split push. It was never Olaf pushing up, getting the vision control, getting the help from his team, and turning that one over.
Yeah.
Rakdos Olaf can do crazy things to people, and it never happened.
Yeah, they never went for pressure onto Chunky Fresh.
Never.
Chunky Fresh really only died in team fights. They never were able to go to the source of the split, never go to the source of the TP, never put pressure on him, and I feel like that was a missed opportunity, especially when it's a Hecarim.
Right, and that's what I mean about this, is like C9T, they make aggressive calls, but they don't often make the right calls here. Just the slow and steady burn of, let's go mess with Hecarim, who's fighting without a turret in his lane. You just kill the guy a bunch, right? That's possible. It is easy to do. Like, obviously, different leagues of teams, but like CLG would just like kill Chucky Fresh 7 times as an example, right? Like, that's what the best teams, at least in the region, will do, is they will look for the weak points and they will strategize for the opponent team. This is all very future-seeking, but I think this is the kind of thing C9T needs to do. Play to the enemy team, play to what your team does, go dominate your lanes, dominate your early game like you did, and then capitalize on the individual lanes, not just like go knock down a mid turret against Victor.
Yeah, because they had about a 1.6k gold advantage. We're talking 11 minutes in the game very early on, but pressuring, spending that gold on wards, pressing up your ward line, getting more turrets for it. Mm-hmm. They just started to group up and bang their heads against a Victor Braum, and you saw how that worked. It didn't.
It did not. And especially, again, you think about the team composition here. Imagine's very teamfight focused, ridiculous teamfight power. Victor is in there. He's ludicrous. He's got amazing things. You know, Imagine need to get picks. They've got Lulu. They've got Olaf. They've got really individual playmakers, and they didn't play the individual game.
Yeah, and I feel like that was a big missed opportunity here. Coming into the next game, though, I want to see, you know, banning away some of Chunky Fresh's champions. I know it's very strange to say.
You know
exactly
what
he'll play. It's so strange to say, but you know exactly what he'll play.
We'll see if they can get rid of that one. It's going to be a great game coming up, guys. As we get ready for game two, we're going to take a short break. When we come back, Team Imagine attempts to reach the Spring Promo Tournament with one more win against Cloud9 Tempest. Don't go anywhere. And here's the push on in. He chooses to go for the Olaf. Gets the fear onto four of them. It's a slaughter right now. Team Imagine pushing in 3-for-1 so far. Flashes goes in, looks for Sheep. Who gets the full wave, but lodges with the Vaporid of Mancloud doing big damage. Sheep's going to go down too. He's going to look for Solo going down, though. One for nothing. They're going for the second chases here. And Lod's going to lose his life. Three kills picked up already.
TP from behind.
Looks for the blade. Knocks
Nobody's there.
A lot of damage, but Hard has no teammates at all. They got gummed up.